A lot of people say, can we have a two-party system? That's the ideal. That's how many developed countries work. That's what you should aim for, change of government from team the first party to the second, and then from the second to come back, and then you are considered to have matriculated. But how could this happen in Singapore that we have two parties? I can imagine several scenarios. First, the society splits based on race or religion. You have one party representing one race or religion, another party representing another race or religion. That's the worst possible scenario for Singapore, and we've done our best to make sure that it never comes about. Because if you're split on race or religion, you're not just going to have political quarrels, you're going to divide the society, and that's the end for Singapore. The second possibility is that you divide on class lines. We don't get our economic policies right, or maybe just the world trends are such. The rich get richer, the poor don't make progress. After a while, the poor lose hope in the system. The rich lose interest in the rest of society. And they say, so one side says, tax me less, let me keep my wealth. The other side says, give me more, transfer more welfare, more goodies, more benefits. And you have two parties forming, one representing one group, the other one representing the other group, rich and poor. I think we should try, to the maximum extent that we can, align all the interests of Singaporeans and make sure that one party can represent you, whether you are the CEO or whether you are the taxi driver. The third possibility is that we split on policy grounds. You argue that this set of policies will be best for Singapore to grow, promoting MNCs. They argue that, no, I don't want MNCs. Sending them all away and depending on Singaporeans and Singapore companies is a way to grow, and we can't reconcile, and we split and we argue over the policies and fight it out in the polls. I think that could happen, but it's not so likely because the PAP is a pragmatic party and we are ready to take in good ideas. But the most important reason why a two-party system is not workable is because we don't have enough talent in Singapore to form 2A teams, to form two really first-class teams to govern Singapore really well. More than any other country, Singapore needs exceptionally able leadership to tackle challenges and to minimize the risks for our country. We are small, we are vulnerable. With a mediocre government, other countries may muddle through and have to muddle through, but Singapore will fail. The most effective way to get a two-party system, if you really want to do it, is to split the PAP in two, because the talent is there, is gathered. We'll have two persons. I choose one, you choose one. I choose one, you choose one. Okay, now we have two teams. Now we play, toss the coins. We seriously considered making the PAP two parties, not that way, but in principle, but we didn't do it. Because we couldn't solve one problem. How can you make two teams, each one as good as the original one team which we had, which took really what would have been the best players from both teams? Or to put it in very hard and direct, tangible terms, where can you find two finance ministers and two defense ministers? I have one finance minister and one defense minister. If you have a spare one somewhere, please let me know. Why do I choose these two? Because these are two of the most difficult jobs in the cabinet to fill. In finance, you have to make judgments on taxes affecting all Singaporeans, on expenditures affecting all ministries, on the budget. You're talking about $50 billion of expenditure every year, as well as on our reserves, GIC, Temasek, MAS, and others, adding up to more than $100 billion. To find one of them is not easy. to find two of them, you must really obey Pio. It's the same with defense. In a curiously opposite way, because finance is about money and is very difficult, and defense is very difficult because it is not about money. Because the bottom line is intangible. Security, risk, threats, judgment. What is worth spending on? What is worth investing on? Which is the right aeroplane to buy? How many ships do you need? Which colonels to make general? How to shape the SAF? Which threats are getting serious? When do I recommend to mobilize the SAF? When do I decide I must deploy and defend? Can you easily find anybody off the street to do that sort of job? Very, very difficult. So therefore, I think one team, get the best people together, fill each job with the best man. If we split it into two teams, then whichever one is in charge, the government is going to be weaker and the chances of something going wrong will go up. Definitely, even if things don't go wrong, standards will go down. And that's why I and all my predecessors have gone out of our way to scour the land for talent to join the team. And every election we have 20-odd candidates become new MPs. And out of these, on average, I did a count over the last 5 or 6 elections, about 3 make it to become minister. But we have 14 ministries to fill. And then on top of that, you need some supervising ministers, some DPMs, some senior ministers, because you need some additional experience and oversight of the system. So just say 14 ministries to fill, and I can get 3 new ministers each term. You do the math. 14 divided by 3 means, on average, each minister has to serve at least 4 terms. The opposition parties pitch themselves as offering Singapore a fallback should the PAP fail. It sounds plausible, but if you think about it, what does it depend on? Most critically, it comes back to talent again. If the PAP can't assemble a second team, I don't think the opposition will find it easier to do that. You look at it from the micro view. Consider a capable person weighing his options. He wants to serve the nation, he's trying to decide how to do it, which way he should go. And he has 2 choices. First choice, join the opposition, oversee the PAP, but really spend his life, and can be quite a long time, waiting and watching, just in case the PAP screws up, then he'll be ready to take over. The other alternative is join the government, help it to make better decisions, implement good policies, and avoid making mistakes and screwing up. Now, which makes more sense for him and for Singapore? So, I think for all these reasons, I think the best thing for us to do is to concentrate our resources and form one really strong Singapore team. Some people will want to join the opposition. Yes, they'll want to propound alternative policies or they'll want to be a check on the government. That's valid. By all means, join the opposition, especially if the government is wrong or incompetent. But so long as the government is competent and doing a good job for Singaporeans, I hope you will make common cause with it and help us to ensure that things stay right. But what we can do and must do to assure Singapore's future is to develop the strongest possible A team with depth and resilience. Competent ministers, people with expertise in different ministries, plus depth, younger ones learning the job, so that as the situation changes, as we have new needs, we can always find the right person for the right job. And if one person doesn't work out, I can do a replacement, I can call a timeout, change my team member, and the game goes on. Actually, that's how soccer is played. If you watch World Cup soccer, every country only has one team. No country fields two teams for the World Cup soccer. You have one national soccer team, you have reserve players, you have coaches, you can change players, and if need be, you can even change the coach. But you concentrate all your talent, make one team, and give it your best shot, whether it's Johannesburg or Rio de Janeiro. And I think that's what we should do. We're not so successful in soccer, but we are not doing badly in government. And I think that we should keep up our winning streak and stay in the Championship League in the international contest of nations.